Nils Ivar Bohlin was born on July 17, 1920, in Hernesand, on the coast of central Sweden. He studied mechanical engineering and gained his Bachelor of Sciences degree by graduating in 1939. He was hired as an engineer designer by the Swedish aircraft manufacturer Svenska Aeroplan Aktiebolaget, also known as Saab. It was during his tenure at Saab that the company developed their famous J-21A1 airplane, often referred to as simply the Saab 21. The Saab 21 is a Swedish single-seat low-wing monoplane fighter and attack aircraft. It used a twin boom fuselage with a pusher engine, giving the aircraft an unusual appearance. This pusher propeller engine, which was mounted behind the cockpit, necessitated the invention of the ejection seat for emergency pilot evacuation in case of a malfunction or being shot down by enemies. Want to guess who worked on that evacuation seat design? You guessed it, it was Nils. He continued to work in aerospace development at Saab until 1958, when, with his reputation for safety engineering well established, he joined the Volvo Automotive Division to lead safety feature development. At that time, to ensure safety for their cars, Volvo offered an accessory lap belt for their first unibody car, the PV444. From his research with Saab aircraft, Nils knew about the stresses these belts placed on the human body during high-speed collisions, as well as people's resistance to uncomfortable restraint devices. And who can blame them? Just look at this old, scary-looking children's seat. Doesn't exactly instill confidence when looking at it, although it's certainly better than this one. Regardless of how it might look, even in the 1950s, there was much talk about car safety, as safety belts were slowly becoming an important consideration when purchasing a new car. For example, this Ford leaflet goes on to describe how their belts are comfortable and safe. They even give some advice on how to position yourself in case of quick stops, fast turns, and emergencies. But most importantly, they came in multiple colors. At Volvo, Nils was hard at work as his safety belt crossed the strongest parts of the body, restraining one shoulder, which prevents the driver from flying forward to contact the steering wheel or dash as the result of sudden deceleration, and restraining the lower core across the hips. This device provided effective protection independent of the strength of the occupant's seat. It was simple to buckle, adjustable, and allowed some freedom of upper body movement. It was so effective that in August of 1959, Volvo sent Nils to America to demonstrate his invention under the freshly filed US patent number 3.043.625 to the Consumer Product Safety Commission. The patent was approved a few years later on 10th of July 1962. Volvo began installing the device as a standard safety feature in its vehicles. Volvo also became the first company to implement Bohlin's design into its vehicles as standard equipment. Of course, many drivers and passengers were opposed to using them. Some believed that seatbelts were uncomfortable and restrictive. Others thought they were unnecessary or even harmful, fearing they could cause injuries in certain types of crashes. Overcoming this resistance required extensive public education and legal mandates. Now, I wouldn't say you are mandated to click that subscribe button down below, but we sure would appreciate it. Regardless of the public's initial restraint, Volvo's revolutionary seatbelt design was made available to other manufacturers at no cost in the name of safety. You heard that right. Volvo released the patent and made it free to use by anyone in the name of safety. As part of the movement to improve safety, all cars manufactured in the US from the year 1968 onwards were mandated by the Traffic and Motor Vehicle Safety Act to use the improved three-point safety belt. Interestingly, buses were excluded in this act. Now let's take a look at how the seatbelt functions. There are three elements at work: the retractor, the belt, and the buckle. Let's look at the retractor first. This is the part that lets the belt move when you pull on it, but locks it in the event of an accident. It works based on the central operating element, a centrifugal clutch. The clutch is a weighted pivoting lever mounted to the rotating spool. When the spool spins slowly, the lever doesn't pivot at all. A spring keeps it in position. But when something yanks the belt, spinning the spool more quickly, centrifugal force drives the weighted end of the lever outward and locking the belt. Now let's take a look at the belt part of the seat belt, which is in the industry referred to as the webbing. Modern seatbelt webbing has a high tensile strength ranging from 3,000 to 6,000 pounds in order to resist tearing at high loads, such as during high-speed collisions. While nylon was used in some early seat belts and is still used for lap belts, it was replaced by 100% polyester due to its better UV resistance, lower extensibility, and higher stiffness. Nylon was also prone to stretching more than polyester and was prone to wear and tear, with tiny abrasions drastically reducing tensile strength, causing a lack of reliability in one of the most important safety measures in a vehicle. Seatbelts are commonly 1.8 or 1.9 inches wide, with a 2-2 herringbone twill, also called the broken twill weave, which is the distinctive V-shaped weaving pattern used to maximize the thread density, increasing its tensile strength. Modern seatbelt weaves also feature snag-proof edges, reinforced with strong polyester threads to prevent excessive wear and tear on the edges, while still remaining flexible. The only part remaining is the seatbelt buckle. The first seatbelt to be mass-produced in the United States in the 1950s and 1960s used a seatbelt buckle similar to the ones still used on today's commercial airplanes, called a lift cover or lift lever buckle. This buckle had many weaknesses, the biggest being that the lift cover could be accidentally dislodged by the occupant's motions inside the vehicle, leaving the occupant unrestrained in an accident. General Motors' Robert Fisher innovated on this design with their seatbelt buckle in 1965. It operated similarly to the lift cover buckle, but used a protected button on the side of the buckle for the lift cover. This was the first major side release or top release style buckle used in the US. This buckle was patented in 1965 and was called the Maxi Buckle. In the late 1980s in Europe, the first end-release tongue-eject buckles were developed. The end-release buckle has the release button on the end of the buckle, next to the tongue insertion point, instead of on the top or side of the buckle. Locating the release button on the end of the buckle prevents a side load from accidentally causing the release button to be activated, preventing inertial unlatching. All of the automakers have now transitioned into the European-style end-release buckles, which are in use today. Now that we have seen everything there is to see with seatbelts, let's return to our friend Nils, whose story doesn't end with just the seatbelt. He continued in engineering development for Volvo for many years to come. Some other innovations credited to him are the stepless adjustable lumbar support for the 1964 122's driver's seat, as well as doing in-depth research on side impact injury prevention. The results of this research came to market in the 1990s as Volvo's side impact protection system, which distributed impact forces throughout the car in a controlled manner, and which in final form included side impact airbags. He retired from Volvo in 1985 at the age of 65. The seatbelt remains his greatest achievement, as America's National Highway Traffic Safety Administration estimates that in the US alone, it saves more than 15,000 lives and prevents more than 100,000 injuries each year. To show appreciation for his invention, Nils was honored with a 1999 induction in the Automotive Hall of Fame, 2002 induction in the National Inventors Hall of Fame, as well as a 1995 gold medal from the Royal Swedish Academy of Engineering Sciences. In his life, he really did achieve a lot, although it might be worth noting that Bohlin doesn't necessarily deserve all the credit for coming up with the idea for a three-point safety belt that covers the shoulder and waist. In 1951, when Bohlin was still at Saab, U.S. patent number 2.710.649 was submitted by Roger W. Griswold and Hugh DeHaven for a combination shoulder and lap safety belt. As we can see, it's very similar to the solution Nils presented. This became known as the CIR Griswold restraint. The patent application described it as being suitable for various situations where restraint of the human body was required. Bohlin, however, did improve on this concept and came up with a more effective version that could be pulled across the chest and waist with one hand in one swift movement. He said, "I realized that both the upper torso and the lower part of the body had to be held securely in place, with one belt across the chest and another across the hips." Today, seat belts are widely recognized as one of the most important safety features in vehicles and are required by law in most countries. They reduce the risk of death for front seat passengers by about 45% and the risk of serious injury by 50%. In the US, more than half of car crash fatalities involve individuals who were not wearing seat belts at the time of the accident. This suggests that many of these deaths could have been prevented with seatbelt use. Thanks to Nils Bohlin's innovative thinking and commitment to safety, millions of lives were saved and countless injuries prevented over the decades. His contribution goes beyond just an invention. It's a testament to how one idea can make a profound impact on society. If you like this video, buckle up and watch another. And don't forget to subscribe, as there are more videos coming.